universal suffrage without any form of screening. Thank you. Dr. Fernando Cheung. Thank you. Mr. Deputy, this is already the seventh budget of the incumbent FS. He expected a deficit of $4.9 billion. And in effect, we have a surplus of $12 billion. Yes, the SF enjoys coffee and likes French movie. I think his memories for Hong Kong will be overestimation of expenditure and underestimation of our revenue. I thank the Electrical Research Division for a brief research report. It is pointed out that in 2005, in that fiscal year, revenue was underestimated by $442 billion and overestimated expenditure up to $140 billion. So that's a difference of over $500 billion. That's huge. He's the treasurer, the bursar of the city. He's the FS. And yes, he can't even get the basic arithmetics right year on year. So how much confidence can we have in this budget? We keep telling the people of Hong Kong that we have to be conservative because we don't really have enough money, and we have a working group on long-term fiscal planning, a new move this year, and a report has been published. I think the basic tone is we have to plan for a rainy day and we have to think for the future because we don't really have enough. Not enough, not really enough. We're talking about a structural deficit. Is there anything more ridiculous than this? In the past 10 years, fiscal surpluses have reached $470 billion. We have a surplus, we had a surplus every year. Of course, you may say that in the past 17 years, there were 5 years where we were in the red, but for the remaining years, we did have surpluses. And our economic pie is growing bigger and bigger. Our GDP has grown by about 60%. And what about our wages? Just about 10%. The Foreign Reserve of the Hong Kong government is now $316 billion, US dollars, or $2,400 odd billion. This does not take into account our reserves. If we take $760 billion of reserves into the account, then we have actually $3.2 trillion at our disposal. If we disregard our own reserves, if we consider our foreign exchange reserves, we rank number 9 in the world, and our foreign reserve per capita, we rank the 3rd in the world. So if we just look at the exchange reserve, we get over $300,000 per capita in Hong Kong dollars. I think we're so rich compared with other countries that it is unimaginable. We're not talking about money in the market, but money in public coffers. We are so rich. And yet, the FS said that we should plan for rainy days. All right, that's okay. This is something we should always do. But please take a look at the current situation. The Commission on Poverty has announced this report. 19% of our population is living below the poverty line. Close to 1 out of every 5 residents in Hong Kong is below the poverty line. Isn't it a shame? Even after transfer of social welfare, even We have taken into account CSSA and OAA. About 15% of our population is living under the poverty line. One out of every seven persons in Hong Kong is poor. Is it that our wealth is dwindling? Have we got less since the handover? The answer is no. We've got richer and richer. Where has the money gone? Does the administration has the responsibility to redistribute wealth in our budget so that people can all share the fruits of economic prosperity? Or should we allow the wealth gap to continue to exist? Even though wealth is accumulating, we have a marked percentage of our population living in distress. I think this is beyond what is acceptable in an advanced economy. We talk about close to 20% of our population, even taking into account social welfare benefits. About 15.2% of the people in Hong Kong are still poor. Now, one-third of them are elders, or one-third of our elders are poor. One-quarter of kids below 14 years old are poor. One-quarter. How can that be? What kind of a society is this? We keep talking about economic growth, creating a bigger pie so that everyone can benefit. Now, we are masters of our own society, and the SAR government is to serve Hong Kong instead of the U.S. Sovereign state. So have things improved? Have we seen an improvement in poverty? No, the situation has gone from bad to worse. So what is this budget for? The senior officials are pondering every day how they can promote economic development so that people can enjoy better quality of life. They have talked about this for many years. Have they done anything to make it happen? And you say that because people are aging, in the future we'll run out of money, so we may as well set up a future fund first. What problems do we face here? Do you know how many people are living in subdivided units? According to an official survey, 170,000. And then according to a survey in the community, to over 200,000. Many families are living in SDUs. You don't need me to remind you how appalling the conditions are. And some government officials dared to say that SDUs had value. How many patients in Hong Kong are denied proper medication because of a lack of means? You just read the news. Today on Apple Daily, there's a case reported, a young person suffering from lymphoma. He's only 32 years old, and he is searching for a self-financed drug that will cause him over $230,000. The Apple Fund has funded him $110,000. He has to make up for the shortfall. And the Oriental Daily, a taxi driver who is over 67 years old. He has a neuroma, and he has to spend over $30,000 on drug per month. Every day we have such cases. We have got such cases reported on the newspapers every day. We find a metropolis where in the newspaper we have such cases reported. A certain patient has exhausted his savings, he cannot afford drugs anymore, so please extend a helping hand. Do you find similar cases in other places? And do you know how long do you have to wait at the A&E department? How long do you have to wait to see a specialist at public hospitals? And how long do you have to wait to see a psychiatrist? Is it that because we have no money? Let's take a look at our education. Children with special education needs. Well, you talk about early identification and detection. You say that from 0 to 6, that there's the critical period for identification and detection. But they have to wait until they're over 6 before they have access to services. So it's just a pack of lies when you talk about early identification and detection. Over 10,000 secondary students passed the basic requirement for tertiary education, but they are just as qualified because of lack of places.
Other countries encourage people to study. They give you money to study because we're talking about knowledge economy. But we don't have anything here. You have to pay for everything. It's been over 20 years. Still, there is no increase in number of university places. This year, we have won 500 from 14,500 to 15,000, only once. This is a joke. Is it because the Hong Kong SARG doesn't have money? No. We have no land to build universities? No. Why? Well, what are you talking about when you say knowledge economy? These youngsters, they have met the requirements, but they don't have a place to study. When it comes to education, housing, social welfare, there are a lot of elderly people waiting for personal care services. Every one of us ages. We have good economic development today thanks to their contribution. But who are there to help them in their twilight years? A lot of them are living the rest of their life in a private home with poor conditions. And if in a family an elderly member suffers from dementia, then he or she will need the care of family members around the clock. If you want to employ a foreign domestic helper to take care of the patient, sometimes even the domestic helper cannot put up with it and simply leaves. And you have to stay at home to take care of the patient without being able to go to work. And if you want to wait for a care home place, well, sometimes you die before you get a place. Every year we see an increase of just several hundreds of places, but there are tens of thousands of people waiting. Every year there are 5,000 people who die before they get a place. I don't think that with 5,000 people dying, then the rest, the other 25,000 people will get a place. No, they won't get a place the next year or the year after. So you can't take care of elderly people, you can't take care of people with disabilities. If you're waiting for a place in RCHD, the waiting time is even longer, over 10 years. So what are you talking about when it comes to public administration? You people talk about caring for the poor and the underprivileged. You talk about improving the economy, then people's livelihood would improve. How? I don't see any improvement. Where is the improvement for our grassroots? Is it, well, do you mean you want their living conditions to improve just like what the CE said? But when do they get the improvement and where is it? The quality of life is not proportional to our economic development. Our society has become unjust to the extreme. And our wealth gap ranks the first. It's not according to me, it's according to the United Nations. This is the society we're in. We represent the people. Apart from feeling inferior, what else can we do? We don't have a political structure in which we can genuinely reflect the views of the public. Our voice, when it comes to a vote, is always a minority. You can't even provide basic services in an adequate way. We have wealth gap. One-fifth of the population lives in poverty. This is an affluent society. How can you turn a blind eye? How can you say that there is nothing you can do? You're left to your own devices. they do bits of everything. And as a result, you have to wait a long time for everything. If you are lucky and you have family members taking care of you, then you will find a solution in the market. Otherwise, you're left on your own. What are you talking about when you're saying that we should promote our traditional Chinese values and cultures? This budget will only aggravate the already serious wealth gap.
I've just listened to Bernardo's speech. It would be very difficult and heartless if I spoke against what he has just spoken on the aspect of special need education, on the aspect of help for the elderly, on the aspect of alleviating the poverty problem in Hong Kong. I'm sure the government must have acknowledged what he has said, but taking into consideration of an overall macro view of economics, Hong Kong government, even in the days of colonial days and since 1997, one of the top priority of Hong Kong is to look after those who are in need. Never this government or former governments have actually abandoned those people who are in need, particularly the elderly, the underprivileged, and those who suffer from normal development. Mr. President, with the encouragement of the last chief executive policy speech of giving, it is understandable that the public has been overly excited about the prospect of the budget, and particularly for details of sweeteners, these giveaways, originally aimed at coping with the short-term financial pressures, became the de facto recurrent expenditure items. And the guessing game ensured each year as to how much the government would offer. Listening to the speeches of the honorable members during the last 24 hours, it appears that we are living in a strange time. We must be thinking that we are living in abject poverty. We are living that the times are so bad that we need handouts. But in fact, we are living in an age of prosperity. But how that prosperity is being shared, that's another question. Remembering the days of the budget deficits during the period after 1997, were we happier then than we are then now? Were we just one heart to fight against the economic gloom? Were we then one spirit to overcome the economic financial tsunami? We were there to fight against the economic enemy. Now that we are at a different position, we tend to ask for more and more. Just think about the governments of Spain, Italy, Portugal, and others, where the politicians spent as much as they could to buy votes. They got into power and run the government by giving. But what they ended up in, one word, bankruptcy. Is this what we want for Hong Kong? No, we don't want things like this to happen in Hong Kong. As I said earlier, the public mood was high, but it was dampened when the financial secretary gave his speech on the 2014-2015 budget. The sweeteners this year appear to be less sweet given that the government recorded a provisional surplus of 12 billion, far less than the approximately 65 billion recorded last year. In addition, the financial secretary alerted the public this year that a structural deficit could surface in 7 years following the report by the specialist group. If government expenditure continues to grow and outpace economic and revenue growth. The secretary was even accused of creating public panic in society by making hasty projections. Truly, he has not. He has only tell what he has seen and believe what he has actually studied. Mr. President, unlike the chief executive, who always plays the good guy, like all other politicians, the financial secretary always plays a thankless role in pointing out the financial realities in view of the possible deficit as anticipated in the report. It is advisable to be cautious in times of prosperity in order to plan proactively for our future and remind ourselves to strictly adhere to the principle of prudent financial management. Let me tell you a story from the Old Testament. There was a parable of Joseph. When he, being a Jew, he went to Egypt and he was made the minister in charge of finance. During the 7 years of surplus, Joseph actually spent less and stored up all the surpluses of grain and stored them in safe place. People were complaining, criticizing him, a Jew, you don't understand our position. Why not spend everything? Let us enjoy the abundance of the times. Joseph said, trust me, because we have to do it for the lean years that we will have, because not every year will be a year of surplus. After the 7 years of surpluses, came 7 years of drought. The people were hungry. So Joseph opened the gates of the grain storage and shared the spoil with the people. And then they said, oh, how great is Joseph. This is exactly what the FS is doing. Do you want the FS to act without responsibly to hand out everything that we have today? The answer is no. No one would deny that the Honorable John Zhang has been competent at ensuring Hong Kong's healthy financial position and controlling expenses tightly. In drawing up the budgets, he has never deviated from the principles of keeping expenditure within limits of revenues. As the old parables of Joseph indicated and taught us, even during the financial tsunami in those days, as set out in Article 107 of the Basic Law, John Zhang did comply to that. During his term of office, the government has recorded $253 billion in total budget surpluses, an average of $42 billion per year. We are therefore fortunate to have such a prudent financial secretary. However, the government is still being accused of being overly prudent. And luckily, John Zhang is not a politician. He is truly a manjakunyun, responsible to the people. He is truly a manjakunyun to the people, not to an individual. On 25th of March, the research office of this council secretariat published a research brief, 2014-2015. This brief reveals the well-known secret that the government holds a poor record in accurately forecasting budget surpluses or deficits. It's very easy to criticize. Can we ask the writer, the author of this article, can he forecast the surplus or the deficit that we will be facing this year? Particularly a government who is committed to spending. And like a company, if you don't make money, you cut. A government cannot do this. A responsible government cannot do this. You have to make ends meet. So to criticize is easy, but for prudent management is really difficult. Even though, as I said earlier, the secretary is not an accurate forecaster, he is not a fortune teller like Tony Chen. He is no doubt a responsible and pragmatic secretary by showing financial commitments to public policies. The government expenditure has been growing since 2010-2011, and it has reached a peak in 2013-14, stood at 400 and reached a peak in 2013-14 stood at 435 billion, on the face of escalating expenditure. It may win some applause among the public. However, the budget is an exercise of art of distribution rather than the mathematic game of spending as though there is no tomorrow. Whenever a politician promises you something, every voter should ask.
其實每一個投票人或者是個選民都要去問這個從政人士，就是說究竟現在我們的問題是怎樣呢？怎麼可以解決到呢？其實這個都是一個很基本的選民的責任來的。一些非政府的開支呢，其實呢就是有很急劇的增長了，就是由於現任的財政司司長呢，其實呢也都是有一些的一次性的派糖措施。 所以其實就是09至13年，其實有350億元的經常性開支，就是比起之前。
2004 and 52, 2008 and 9, while recurrent expenditure has risen by only 25% over the same period, it is not surprising that the Secretary, who is stuck between populism and prudent financial ideology, has in the past and the present opted for the middle and conservative road by handling out one-off sweeteners because, on one hand, this allowed him to respond quickly to social grievances and, on the other, allow long-term expenditure to be avoided. This year, in fulfillment of the CE, part of the CE electoral promises, set aside $20 billion for so-called one-off measures, which now actually become recurrent measures, sad as those, is going to be a burden for the Hong Kong people. We must consider to what extent the extra allowance for those in need or those partly in need will remedy the disparity between the rich and poor. The best method, the best way to deal with cross-generation poverty is through education and not by handouts. And to what extent the reduction in salaries and profit tax will alleviate the difficulties faced by the middle class and the SME? It is obviously not a matter of sweeteners, but rather a question of effectiveness of using public money in such a way. Now let me turn to education policy. Mr. President, Acting President, in the area of education, recurrent expenditure on education will be $67 billion for the next financial year, which is 5.3% higher than in 2013, comprising the largest area of government recurrent expenditure. We actually, this $67 billion is amounted to some of the first-rate development countries' budget for education. But the result that we spend in first-rate developed countries' expenditure on education, we are producing third-rate graduates. The government, it's about time that they should do a regeneration in terms of the education system and to make good use of what the resources gave them. It's not a matter of how much money you pump in. It's really a matter of how money is to be invested for the future. And I totally support my colleagues, especially Fernando, who is talking about the use of money in education for the worthwhile of the community. Education is an investment for the future and the present. It's not a cost to this community. Also, I would urge the government to revisit the UGC, to revamp their whole organization. It's about time that UGC needs a regeneration and to ensure that the tertiary education is being well-funded and meaningfully funded and to encourage the growth of Hong Kong education. This, I hope the Minister of Education or the Secretary for Education have the gut and the courage to do that and just don't use the same old tactic that this is tradition. There is no tradition. We have to think about the out-of-the-box measures to do it. Now, as my time is coming short, I'll talk about the problems that is facing the construction industry. The cost per square foot construction in construction unit is about $4,000. It's because of the rising material costs and, more importantly, the cost of labor. We are short of labor in Hong Kong. If we procrastinate and try to find a political solution, Hong Kong would have to pay, be penalized. We will have cost delay for all our projects, that there will be no delivery of, there will be no delivery of flats, which will push up further the prices of flats. And this is not what the government wants or aim to have. Thank you, Mr. President.
Ms.
Sito, thank you, Mr. Deputy. This year's budget, after its release, there aren't that many new ideas. DFS is still insisting on being conservative, and actually he has gone even further, suggesting that in the medium term, we may have a financial risk, that is our spending won't there will be a structural deficit, and the fastest would be in 7 years. And the main reason is that we have an aging population and our productivity is coming down. That's why he has suggested that we should set up this future fund in order to provide reserve money or backup money for our infrastructure projects. And he will also be using infrastructure projects to drive domestic demand so that our economy will still maintain some vibrancy and vitality. Well, that's true, because when we project into the future, we should have a sense of crisis. I think that's only right, and it's also a responsible way in going about our business. But then how are we going to resolve this crisis situation? I think there are different ways and approaches, but then regrettably, the FS has adopted a very regressive approach, and the Labour Party's stance is that instead of cutting down on social services, which might affect people's livelihood, which is a very conservative way of doing things, and instead of setting up this future fund to provide for critical expenditure on infrastructure, we should put aside a reserve in order to stimulate domestic demand by creating jobs. We should have invested in social developments, including education. We should have a more diversified economy so that everyone in a community will have this ability and opportunity to develop his potential. In fact, balancing the budget will mean that we will have to open up more sources of revenue and cut down on our spending, and that would also include a review of our tax regime. Some members have spoken about a progressive tax regime so that for companies that are able to make more money, we'll have to pay more tax. And also, we should also have a dividend tax so that for those who are able to make money from the community, will be able to pay it back to the public coffers. And what user pay, and also those who are able to pay more should pay more. That has been the long-standing philosophy, so that for the 1% who is extremely rich, over the years, out of the 99% of the population, they've been able to make earnings out of the fruit of their hard work. And when we have problems in our finances, then so from these people who have made the most of the revenue, they should pay it back to the community. But then the administration has been favoring this 1% of the rich, and this is their usual practice. And what they've been doing is that they're going to increase water charges, which is something that everybody will have to pay and every household will have to pay. And in fact, the working group on long-term fiscal planning suggests that our assets should be securitized or securitized. In simple terms, they are actually targeting the poor. In fact, when you look at the housing estates and shopping centers, which used to be run by the housing authority, and they've been sold off to the link REIT. And as a result, people's burden has increased. Well, in the past, many SMEs who used to operate in these shopping centers have been forced out, and many of the daily necessities have become more expensive these days. Another example is the MTRC. Well, when the MTRC shares were sold and the corporation got listed, the corporation had two duties. Number one, they will have to be responsible to the minority shareholders. And on the other hand, the administration as the majority shareholder should be accountable to the public at large. But then what we have seen is that, the MTRC being a trunk transport motor for the majority of the public, well, irrespective of the fact that they've been making huge profits, is still insisting on increasing its fares. And therefore, this kind of agreement by selling off government-owned assets, well, in the end, it's the public who will suffer. So when we can see that with an aging population, there would be this revenue shortfall, we should not have adopted that approach. On the other hand, we should have seriously consulted the public whether or not we're going to introduce this large amount of dividend tax and so on. Well, in the past, when our economy was doing well, people had to put up with inflation. But then when the economy turns for the worse, then we're actually increasing the burden. This is not just. Well, by opening up more sources of revenue, it's not just about taxation. We can also look at how we can nurture more talents, we can have more creativity, so that the ability for everyone to make wealth would be increased, and that would also help make up for the consequence of an aging population. That's why all along we have been saying that the administration should have put in more resources in education, and yet, regrettably, we have been saying that for elementary education, for primary and secondary education, there should be small class education so that the students will be able to lay a solid foundation in terms of their language proficiency and mathematics and so on. We have not been able to do that. We should also resort to more electronic education so that students will be able to taught more eclectically so that they would not have to follow the progress in the same class. But then that has not been looked into. And even if when we go to tertiary education, local students and mainland students, well, local students have not been given sufficient opportunities to receive education. That's because the FS has been too conservative. He has been reluctant in putting in resources in investing in our education system. And that's the short-term consequence. But then how about the medium to long-term outcome? Well, the outcome is that in terms of the quality of our labor force, it has come down. And in terms of creativity, it's also far from adequate. In fact, Mr. Deputy, during the past 2 weeks, the pandemocrats have been staging this hunger strike outside the HSBC headquarters. We have heard members of the public expressing their views to us on our future development in our economy and so on. One of the members who has talked to us was someone from Guangzhou, and he said that in the future, in terms of our operating costs, because of the high land premium policy, well, the cost would be driven up. And in fact, in Hong Kong, in terms of your competitiveness, to a very large extent, that will be undermined, because that's been undermined by our high land premium policy. That's why for the administration to build more public housing so that housing costs can come down, that's also something that is urgently needed. And therefore, the administration has the responsibility to identify more sites in industrial sites, and also for civil service cooperatives sites. And for these low-density residential developments, they should also be rezoned with higher density development. These are feasible measures. Next, I'd like to turn to environmental protection and the spending on it. It's very good. And we also have the Bureau Director here. Well, the Bureau will have to come again for the 3 landfills and the 1 incinerator, and together you're actually going to ask for some $40 billion. Will that be approved? Well, it's still very much unknown. And in terms of waste management, the resources that will be required would be rather substantial. But then according to the information provided by the administration, even if the landfills, even if you manage to get the funding for the expansion, the largest one, that is the NT West, it will be the size will be 200 hectares, and the maximum lifespan would be 17 years. Yes, we've been expanding the landfills incessantly, but then this is not sustainable. Therefore, we have to look at it from another perspective. We have to identify a sustainable waste management approach, and the Liberal Party stance is that the administration should be more bold in redeploying resources so as to develop our recycling industry. One, we can create more green jobs. Second, we should also look at this process of recycling and reproduction, so that could also become an economic activity that would yield return. And earlier on, we went to Europe to look at their waste management strategies, and several Scandinavian countries were visited as early as the 70s. They already consolidated their waste management and energy policy, and they've also resorted to economic angles to look at this policy, and that's why they use public funds to encourage the development of new technologies, and they've also delayed this policy of landfilling, because this is not sustainable, and therefore we should resort to administrative measures or even legislation to promote recycling and recovery. But then there is one thing that I'm most concerned about, Mr. Deputy, because we've been talking about the three landfills and one incinerator, and yet the Bureau Director has not indicated his stance very clearly. So will there be recurrent expenditure and also long-term commitment to go about waste management, in particular recycling and recovery?
On various occasions, the Secretary for the Environment said that the $1 billion recycling fund is to kickstart recycling by the market. But I'm concerned that the government will just stop there. After you have started the process, you leave everything to the private sector and you can just wash your hands. The Secretary, on other occasions, also said that members of public should separate waste before the waste left leave home, and then those responsible for collection and recovery can then send the waste to the incinerator and also to the recycling plants. Are there adequate space for separating domestic waste and also cleaning domestic waste disposed of? The view of the Secretary for the Environment is that the citizens should do it within their homes, but in Hong Kong, homes are very small. It's really unrealistic to ask people to separate waste within their homes. Now, there are three types of plastic. From a plastic bottle, and you really cannot separate three types of plastic. You cannot have space for separating wood, glass, tin cans, and the like. If citizens have separated food waste from dry waste, that goes a long way to help the recycling process. There should be recurrent expenditure on handling the waste that have been separated under broad categories, and then further waste separation should be done outside the home by the waste separation business which employ more grassroots workers so that there can be further separation and cleaning. Now, if people have standard working hours, then of course they can separate the contaminated waste from the non-contaminated waste for recovery. But people don't have time, people don't have space, people have worked overtime, and they really are not able to do detailed waste separation. The detailed waste separation should be done within the district. There should be enough grassroots workers doing that. But if the government just pay $1 billion to kickstart the market and then everything is then looked after by the collectors, or waste collectors, then they just do the collection and transportation, and a lot of recyclable materials will just be devoted to the incinerator or the landfills. So waste separation is only, or the waste management is just to dispose of waste that are being cast by the citizens. That is not appropriate. The government departments have to work together. We know that the Environment Bureau can change the law. It also has the duty to get resources to implement the law and also implement the policy. But when it comes to manpower, land, they are not in the hands of the Environment Bureau. Within the government, the department that has the manpower is FEHD. It manages arbitrage, wholesale markets, 37 municipal markets and also RCPs, refuse collection points. And there is also the director of FEH, who is transferred from the Environment Bureau. The department has the manpower and land and resources. So we urge the relevant policy bureaus to participate. And the Secretary for Environment should raise the issue with the CS to get the FEHD involved. And they should consider how they can make good use of their district, their local resources. Whether it is public finance or waste management, the administration should not adopt a short-sighted and piecemeal approach. We are capable of doing more long-term planning and long and better planning. Dr. Leung Ka-lau. Thank you, Chairman. The FS has made many budgets, and the often criticism leveled against him is his wrong estimates. He estimated that there would be a deficit, but it turned out that there were surpluses, and he had to hand out sweeteners to the people. Now, they set up a working group on long-term fiscal planning based on the data in past 30 years. They forecast the income in the coming year, in long-term future. Well, that's a reasonable approach. Historical data have included many factors mentioned by members, such as the change in the tax regime, the increase in social services, and also various controversial issues. It's reasonable to use historical data to do the forecast. But if you look at paragraph 131, according to historical data, in the past 10 years, the average growth rate GDP in real terms is 4.6%. The estimate is that in the coming 20 or 30 years, the growth in real terms would only be 2.8%. There was a downward revision without any reason, without giving any reason. It seems that some artificial or human factor had been introduced. You base the estimate on historical factor data, but your future estimate is revised downwards. And only God knows whether your estimate is right or wrong. This is really professional. I dare not dispute with that. But if your estimate is correct, then what? And what if your estimate is wrong? You can either be right or wrong and nothing else. Assuming that you're right in your estimate, then what is the suggestion by the FS? Control expenditure, and then revenue protection, so on and so forth. Let me now turn to the healthcare situation. As an example, if the estimate is correct, in paragraph 139, the FS said that government departments and public institutions would have to review their expenditure situation, introduce efficiency measures, review to doing more with less. In response to community needs, government will continue to increase recurrent spending, blah, 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 blah. But the problem is, number one, whatever the fiscal situation is, you should do what you say in para 139. Even if you're rich, you still have to do it. You shouldn't waste money. And what is said in para 139? How can you implement that? Say you ask the HA to enhance its efficiency, but that is not what you are doing in terms of funding. You give a lump sum, an envelope to the HA, you calculate the price adjustment and population, and then you add 3% to that. And then afterwards, you leave the HA to its own destiny. After 7 years, say you have nothing more to add to the envelope, to the HA, of the HIA, and then people will have to wait longer for service. There will be a retrogression in service. You can see that everybody is asking for increasing the funding to the HIA. How can you handle that at that time? Now, if you want to cut the expenditure when expenditure cannot be increased, then the biggest problem will be among the or will come from the employees. The allocation resources by a big envelope is not practicable, in particular in dealing with HA, which is a big institution. You will suffer a huge pressure from the public. And how can you prevent the HA from providing worse service? Now, after providing funding to the public institutions, such as the HA, the government should also be involved in formulating macro policies. Say, if the FS is the view that his estimate is right, after 7 years, the structural deficit will start, and then medical graduates will not get jobs because the HA doesn't have more money, so they can't have new recruits. Maybe starting from 2015, you should cut the admission of medical students. And if the service of HA is not good because the allocation resources is not fair, and waiting time doesn't mean that the waiting time is long in all clusters. Now, and the RTHK had a special feature last week and said that some and showed that some clusters over the years had less resources. Therefore, the waiting time of such clusters has all along been long. As for Hong Kong West, the usage rate of rehab beds was less than 50%, but in NTU West, the usage rate was more than 90%. Now, in increasing funding to the HA, if the money is not put where the grievances are the greatest, then you are not putting the money where the mouth is. Let alone discuss the macro policies. In fact, a better allocation within the HA will help to improve service. And there is also a need to set up an independent audit mechanism to check whether the service provided by the HA falls under what is said by the FS in paragraph 139, such services that were outdated and redundant. Now, if you don't do that, then you really cannot make them cut those redundant services. Now, if the working group is wrong in its estimate, say the future economic growth rate in the future 30 years is as good as the previous 30 years. Then if you listen to me, then after you cut the number of medical students, in fact, you still have a lot of money and you can increase the funding given to the HA. So can you introduce a newer concept? Now, the FS is accused of being a miser. I think there is a problem with the situation in Hong Kong. The incomes may be one-off, say, for example, land sales. And the FS has to control recurrent expenditure. If you spend your one-off income on recurrent expenses, then when the one-off income doesn't come anymore, then you will have no money to fund the recurrent expenses. Apart from the issue or the conflict between one-off income and recurrent expenditure, there is also the issue of semi or semi-recurrent expenditure. The expenditure will only be made when you have the money. Is there such an arrangement in health care? Can there be such a flexibility? If the money is given, if all the money is given to DHA, then there is no such flexibility. After you've given the money to DHA, then the DHA will have permanent staff, spend all the money on permanent staff, and when you ask DHA to cut its spending, it will be very difficult. In a certain in respect of services, they can be bought directly basing on the cost of DHA. Now, Dr. Koh say propose a pilot scheme on colorectal cancer, colorectal cancer screening. How is screening done? In overseas countries, as long as you are the age of 15, you can bring your feces for inspection, see if there is blood in the feces. If there is, then you will be given endoscopy and then colonoscopy. And then what is the cost of colonoscopy for the DHA? $10,000 to $30,000, and you have to wait for 6 months. It's very costly. If the administration is willing to pay $400 million to do that, and the cost of DHA is so high and the waiting time is so long, you leave it to the private market. In the private market, you don't need to wait.
Or at most, you wait a week. It's much far better than 6 months. So in the private market, this called standard screening procedure, standard colonoscopy, it's just about $10,000 cheaper than that of the hospital authority. I don't know what's going to happen in the future. I understand there's a healthcare working group looking at the details. So if you ask the people to choose, shall we give this letter, HA provide service on the private market? Well, in the private market, patients don't have to wait, and maybe they can also choose to get local anesthetic. I pay $1,000 or $2,000 extra because I don't like pain. Or since I'm doing the endoscopy, can you also check my stomach? So there is such flexibility in the private market. And say, after 7 years, the government runs out of money, is no longer providing this service, let's say, then there won't be much repercussion. Why? Because colorectal screening, or those who've gone through it, they all look normal from overseas experience. When the government gives them the screening option, people don't take it up. In overseas countries, only about 60% of the people go for the screening. So perhaps in various areas, or perhaps Professor Zhang, or Mr. Zhang, Mr. Matthew Zhang, could it be that you bring a new concept, you know, semi-recurrent expenditure concept under welfare services? Let's say when the government has money, then it launches a scheme for 5 years. When it runs out of money, then it just suspends the service. So therefore, in future, you'll have more flexibility. You'll have regard to the income level of the government. Maybe in the near term, you look at the revenue, whether it's gone up or down, and then you can make a flexible arrangement. Now, just now I said, what about cutting the number of medical students? Let's say I've got it wrong. Maybe people will say you're crazy because there's such a shortage of manpower in the medical sector. How come you're proposing cutting the number of medical students? Perhaps let me again share with you my some of my simple ideas. Now, there's a manpower shortage in the healthcare sector. That's why service is poor. I've said manpower resources are in short supply because there is uneven distribution. Now, some saying that there is a shortage of 300 people in the hospital authority. But then for someone with some administrative experience, they could do the arithmetic, and they'll find 300 people out of 5,500 doctors in the housing authority is about 5%. That means in a department, if the establishment is 20 and you're one short, would it really undermine service so much? Well, I think that's not true. And if I give you the 300 right away, could the hospital authority then immediately improve its service to the public? Of course it can't. Some complain or blame it on the medical association. It's against the importation of labor. That's or importation of overseas doctors. That's why there's this problem. But actually, medical association may oppose the importation of overseas workers, but it's to no avail. Now, the health of the authority may place an advertisement, and actually it hires everyone who comes forward to apply. So our opposition to the importation of overseas worker serves little purpose. And some say we should relax the admission of doctors from overseas, but are they required to sit licentiate examination? If not, then of course we could hire off them. But if we do require licentiate examination, then they won't have enough doctors. Thank you. Mr. Kwok-Wai-keung. Paragraph 105 of the budget, the FS said that a shortage of manpower hampers the development of certain industries. Labor shortage in the construction sector, for instance, would affect the delivery of infrastructure projects. Apart from encouraging young people to join these industries, admitting from abroad talent and workers not available in Hong Kong will also help maintain our competitiveness. I hope that employers, employees, and the community will work towards solutions to the problems through candid and open discussions. End of quote. Now, there's some consultation document on the population policy. They use biased figures to say that there's a shortage of manpower and saying that there may be need to import labor. Now in the budget, the FS is saying something similar. So does it mean that the government has already got its position on the question of importing labor? The FTU stresses once again that we are strongly against extending the importation scheme. There's a shortage of manpower, not because there's a genuine shortage, but rather there is the manpower supply, just that there is no targeted training or long-term planning, so that there is mismatch between jobs and and job seekers. So there are people without jobs, their jobs are not being filled. And if we expand the importation of labor scheme at the end of the day, it will be the workers who suffer, because then employers have no incentive to improve the condition service for their staff. Now, there's a list of 26 trades for speeding up the advanced processing of a supplementary labor scheme. The lifts and escalators trade just this Sunday came out to oppose the importation of workers. The lifts and escalators trade is among the list of 26. They stress that in the past 10 years, their wages have come down rather than gone up. There's no condition to import labor. And they share the same broad principle of the FTU, that is for workers imported. The importation must be done through the vetting mechanism of the Labor Advisory Board. Trade unions must be consulted. There must be measures to prevent abuse. We must make sure the priority is given to local workers. And also, more importantly, we must strengthen training for local workers so that in the long run we could address the problem of a shortage of labor. Now, has the government ever conducted any review why there is a short supply of workers in certain trades, to the extent that the businesses use that as a pretext to want to import labor? Now, these are not new trades. How come all of a sudden the government seems to have been caught by surprise? In the past few years, has the administration ever reviewed what it's done in terms of manpower training? How come those who've joined the trains leave? How come there are trades which people wouldn't join? If they have done such review, how come nothing's come out of it? Last September, Census and Statistics Department statistics show that there are 85,000 vacancies. 7,000 are civil service vacancies. That means just about 78,000 job vacancies in the open market. At the same time, we have an unemployed pool of 130,000, and there's also potential labor workforce of hundreds of thousands. So there is an indeed adequate supply of workers. But then here is a case of making your own noodles. Now you knead the dough, you make your own noodles. It may be cumbersome, but actually you make a nice noodle, which is nutritious and healthy. But importation of labor is like you're just buying instant noodles. So it doesn't taste good, it's not nutritious, but it's just a lazy way to get yourself fed. Next week, the Commerce Industry Panel will consider the funding application for $130 million for training retail workers. The FTU supports in principle the scheme, but this scheme is not enough. Yes, giving subsidy could, to a certain degree, help these trades attract new blood. But then the real problem with the retail industry is about a high wastage rate. Wages are low, and then benefits or long working hours are also the other problems, or lack of benefits and long working hours. Now, when there's a shortfall of a commodity, of course, prices will go up. So although there's a shortage in workers in the retail industry, but wages should have gone up in theory. But all along, retail workers earn low wages. From May to June 2013, there's a survey. The median wage for all workers in Hong Kong is $14,100. But for retail workers, the median monthly wage is only $10,900. So there's a difference of 30%. That means for retail workers, their wage is lower than the median wage of the community. Now, the economy may be vibrant in the past few years, but because of soaring rentals, wages of workers suffer. Many employers have to pay higher rentals, so therefore they have to increase the prices of the commodities, but also cut wages of workers. Now, apart from low wages, there are long working hours, there are few off days, there are no prospects. These are all the problems in the retail trade. Union surveys find that 60% of those surveyed are not happy with their current wage level. 70% in the retail industry points out that there's no training in the trade. And 60% of the retail workers also indicated they suffer from occupational diseases. The median working hours per week is 50.8 hours for retail workers, so they work long hours. Now, the immediate solution to the problem, of course, is to increase wages and enhance the condition service. For example, 5-day week, overtime pay, or reducing the long hours of standing by staff. But we are not asking for too much, actually, because already there are now advertisements in the market saying that some employees are willing to offer such terms, although it's not widespread yet. And then there are other industries with shortage of manpower, like elderly care services or catering services. In the budget, there is no similar arrangement to provide support to these trades. Next, I'm going to talk about qualifications framework. The government has set up a fund worth $1 billion to give support to the qualifications framework. We're not against it, but enhancing the recognition of the qualifications framework needs to be speeded up. That means employers must accept this framework and recognize its credibility. And then such qualifications should be reflected in wages and conditions of service. And then the QF would truly become the octopus in the work market, in a job market. And also, some of the different levels of qualifications have narrow scope. Now, with Scotland and New Zealand, the Education Bureau has signed some cooperation agreements. It's also negotiating with some European Union countries on future collaboration. But still, the scope is limited. We hope there will soon be convergence of the qualifications framework with that in other countries. Then we don't have to consider offering assistance and so on to so people would join the QF. If people will earn high wages, they will certainly want to join the QF. Now, there are rising public aspirations for government services and standards. So for civil servants, they're working long hours, they're under heavy pressure. Since 2000, there's no longer pension for civil service posts. There's only just a mandatory provident fund. So you can no longer say that a civil service job is a cushy job.
In this year's budget, the FS has imposed a cap on expenditure. So you care about your purse. What about morale of civil servants and their workload? If you don't consider the pressure faced by frontline civil servants, if you continue to exploit them so that their job is getting more and more difficult, then FTU is concerned about high wastage rate of civil servants and you cannot attract people to join the civil service. In the coming few years, we are going to see a lot of people retiring from the civil service. And if you cannot attract young people, what would happen to it? And also, there are a group of NCSC staff who are exploited by the government. They work in the same jobs as civil service counterparts. As the SCS has said, their pay is all-inclusive. But actually, they are hired on terms inferior to civil servants' terms. All the benefits, education allowance, healthcare coverage are not offered. So the so-called all-inclusive package is an all-exclusive package. There are 4,746 NCSCs with 5 years of experience or more, and another 700 are sold with 10 years of experience or more. These positions are needed for the long term, but the government is reluctant to convert them into permanent posts. So these NCSC staff are most unhappy about the lack of prospect. The government plans to increase the number of civil service posts by 5,600 or so. I hope you would give priority to NCSC staff because they are experienced. In the coming years, we'll continue to check with the government on the number of NCSC staff who can be successfully employed as civil servants. We also ask the government to take the lead in stopping outsourcing. I received a case concerning the outsourcing of catering services in the FSD. All along, the FSD has engaged cooks who are civil servants to provide catering service in the fire stations. Of course, a cook can only offer a small variety of food items. And now the director of fire services has adopted an approach whereby these civil servants would be allowed to be phased out. They would not employ new people to replace those who have resigned or retired. And now they have an outsourced arrangement. And although they do the same job, they provide the same catering service, they are getting a lower pay. I think the CSB must act as the goalkeeper in this regard. It cannot just say that it's up to the departmental head and to do whatever they want, because we're talking about jobs or duties that have to be discharged in the permanent sense. Let me now turn to Chinese medicine. And as Chinese medicine is popular, my ward office staff is covered by the insurance that I have we have taken out. But for civil servants, Chinese medicine is not included. It said that it's not a standard service of HA, therefore civil servants are not provided with Chinese medicine coverage. But haven't we said that we want to develop the Chinese medicine in Hong Kong? And we are supposedly trying to promote it. So in a way, you are trying to suppress the development of Chinese medicine. The FTU will urge the government to invest in resources to cover this aspect of Chinese medicine service. Mr. Wong Kwok-kin, Mr. Deputy, the budget devotes a lot of paragraphs to Hong Kong's economic development and the potential problems of our fiscal system. And reference has been made to the working group report of the working group on long-term fiscal planning. With an aging population and a declining labor force, revenue would decrease. If expenditure consistently outpaces revenue, then there's no avoiding of a structural fiscal deficit problem. So the FS has gone to great length to remind us to be prudent in managing public finances. Otherwise, as short as 7 years or up to 15 years, we are going to face a structural deficit, fiscal deficit problem. Oh, actually, this can be summarized in one word. Well, let's spend more. Let's spend less, rather. Apart from the advice from the FS that we should spend more, there's nothing concrete or effective in the way of proposals to help us facing the situation envisaged in the report. The only new idea is to set up a future fund so that we can set aside reserve resources. We save for the rainy days, we prepare for the bad days, and also that's the suggestion to transfer the land fund, some $220 billion, and also a part of the annual surplus, and they will be transferred to the future fund. With regard to the setting up of this future fund to help the facing future problems, well, this is a concept I can support. But let's be clear about one thing. What are the problems that we need to resolve or face up to? Is it infrastructure projects in the budget which are useful in promoting the economy, or should it be social issues? CTU is of the view that in the face of an aging population, which is also referred to in the budget, according to government statistics, in 1929, those who are over 65 years of age would account for 17%. In 2029, this percentage would go up to 25%. And in 2041, it will be 32% of the total population. In terms of the number, it's 2.5 million people in that age group. And that is to say, 1 in 3 people will be over 65 years of age. So this tells us that we are going to have an aging population, and by that time one in three people will be an elder. And if we take into account children or young people who are not in the workforce, so our workforce would be one-third or one-quarter of what it is. This is the big problem that we are going to face. And that's an even bigger problem. And that is that for those who have retired, these retirees, we need a retirement protection, which is not in our system. I think the Secretary for Labour and Welfare is well aware of this. Elderly people have to have certain needs, housing, care, and so on. And care for elderly people requires money. We are talking about a few pillars, and savings, MPF, and the safety net in the form of the CSSA. Let's look at savings. When pay is generally low, I don't think many employees can accumulate savings. To them, it's difficult enough to make ends meet. So don't talk about savings. MPF, we have said this many, many times. The government is well aware of our position. The management fee is high. The return is not very high. But the biggest headache is the offsetting mechanism with long service payment and severance pay. So many employees, when they take a look at the MPF account, not much is left in the MPF account, and they cannot use it to lead a retirement life, and they have to fall into the safety net in the form of CSSA. If we are to set up a future fund, these are the biggest problems that we need to address. In the policy, in the budget, the FS said that the future fund is going to be a reserve for infrastructure projects. Of course, we need infrastructure projects to promote our economy. If there are major infrastructure projects and we don't have sufficient money, if there's such a need, and if we learn from the experience of other countries, you can issue bonds. Why don't we make the fund dedicated to addressing the retirement protection in the face of an aging population? In answering my question, one of my questions, FS said that if we would like to carry out infrastructure projects and the burden is passed to the next generation, it's not fair. I would like to tell the FS that for major infrastructure projects, the beneficiaries would be the next generation. So why is it not fair for them to shoulder the burden? If the government has no solutions for offering retirement protection, as a result, in the future, a large group of elderly people would have to rely on social welfare, on CSSA. That would be the biggest burden one can leave to the next generation. I don't know whether Mr. Cheung would agree to with my analysis. Now the government is commissioning a team led by Professor Nelson Child on retirement protection. From what I've heard, the findings will be announced soon. The crucial thing for this to be implemented is to have a big sum of seed money. For for the future fund, you rely on the accumulative 220 billions in the land fund. It can be used as a seed money for the future retirement protection system. We strongly urge the government to adjust the use of the future fund and respond to community worries that we are going to have a big group of retirees who would rely on welfare. The government has so far failed to propose anything effective to address retirement protection. As a result, we don't have a stable society. Employees who are about to retire, who have retired, will all be worried. Before we solve this problem, and at the same time, the FS transfers 220 billion from the land fund to the future fund for just infrastructure projects without solving the problem of retirement protection, then I would say the FS would truly be a miser.
President, now I'd like to talk about tobacco duty. Smoking is hazardous to health. I'm sure there is agreement by the medical sector, between the medical sector and also the society. In 128, paragraph 28 of the budget, the FS said to safeguard public health and to lower the health risk of the public is going to increase tobacco duty. Yes, this is a very decent reason for the duty to be increased. We cannot object to it, but for smokers or with the use of tobacco duty to force people to quit smoking, I don't like this idea. If smoking is so hazardous to health, to life, and leading to higher health bills, what we should do is to gradually ban smoking. Don't allow people to smoke at all. If you use fiscal means to force people to quit smoking, then there is a moral issue involved. Does that mean that those who can afford it, who are wealthy, can continue to smoke? If you continue to increase tobacco duty, then the poor will be the first who cannot afford smoking anymore. And then the retirees as well will have to quit smoking. Those who are well off can continue to smoke. Does that mean that those who are rich can pollute air with their secondhand smoke, jeopardizing people's health? Does that mean that the poor will also lose their right to smoking? I urge the administration to reconsider the use of tobacco duty to force people to quit smoking. Is it a proper means? I think the proper way is to ban smoking directly. If you think that smoking is so hazardous to health, why don't you just ban it? Why have you resorted to fiscal measures? People think that this is a way for the government to increase revenue, and it's also discrimination against the poor. I urge the administration to reconsider this move. Of course, that doesn't mean that we are against any increase in tobacco duty, because as I said, we have no reason to oppose. Mr. President, this year's budget has room for improvement. However, we still find it supportable, and we've been to many consultation forums in the community, and although they still have a lot of aspirations waiting to be addressed by the administration, we believe that blocking the passage of the appropriation bill is a disservice to the community. We are, of course, against the abuse of filibustering. so as or as a means to bargain with the government. This is a waste of public resources. Furthermore, it will add to the workload of our electrical secretariat. It will also add to the workload of honorable members here, because by the end of this legislative year, we'll have a bunching of bills and motions, and we won't be able to cope. Thank you. Mr. Lin Leung. President, you may recall that not long ago, on the 30th of March, there was a heavy rainstorm, and there were hailstorms in different places in Kowloon and the NT. And in Festival Walk, that shopping mall, there was water seepage or dripping from the ceiling, and it was as if we had a spectacular show there. All right. After the rainstorm, I noted that both the FS and CE mentioned that incident in their blog. However, after reading their blogs, you will come to this very interesting observation. Sau-lan said in his blog, and I quote, other than floods in Kowloon, Tong, some glass ceiling cracked, and rain fell into the shopping mall, and airflights were affected. And I go on. Government departments are now helping to relieve the disaster in different parts of the territory. Well, after reading Sau-lan's blog, you might have the impression that we have a major disaster or catastrophe in Hong Kong and the sky has fallen down. However, I quote from Mr. John Zhang, the FS blog here. During the rainstorm, the DSD received 29 flooding reports. The major reason was a blockage of pipes or drains by refuse or vegetation. And after the blocks, the drains were cleared, the water subsided very soon. And he went on to say that the government will continue to invest heavily in infrastructure. I hope that behind these bricks, you can see improvement in people's livelihood. So, different from Mr. Cy Leung, John Zhang felt that the impact of the rainstorm was just minor. And we could also be pleased with our infrastructure, that we were able to cope quite comfortably. Now, they have different interpretations of the rainstorm. Sau-lan regarded it as a major catastrophe, and Mr. John Zhang took it very easy. So, of course, government officials are entitled to different views, and it doesn't matter if they have different views of the same matter. But for really important matters such as management of public finances, if the views are that apart, I think there is cause for worry. On questions of whether money should be spent, and if yes, how much. Now, I'd like to point out from the policy address, paragraph 159. Sau-lan said that I've already said that we must take care of both livelihood and the economy. We understand the need to increase increase expenditure, and also with also the commitment to boost our economy. Unquote. And what did Mr. John Zhang said in his budget? In paragraph 138, he said, and I quote, "We should uphold fiscal disciplines and put in place a more vigorous internal control and monitoring mechanism for assessing and prioritizing competing funding priorities with appropriate offsettings from different programs. We must hold fast to the forecast nominal GDP growth rate." Unquote. How government fiscal resources should be deployed is a serious political decision. But because of this very strange political system, we have the feeling that views are split within the government, and one school is against the other, another. And I'm sure members of the public share my bewilderment. Does the government want to spend more or less? How do we understand the need to increase expenditure, and how we should strictly control government spending? Does the government want to be generous or thrifty? Do we want to spend the money supposed to be for the future generation, or do we want to save for a rainy day? I am very baffled. I think Mr. John Zhang tends to be conservative. He would like to keep spending at a low level, and using various means, the government has got extra sources of income for the government, such as more infrastructure and also one-off relief measures. Although these one-off relief measures are not effective in reducing the wealth gap and has also make it more difficult for people to live, still, the attitude is clear. We know what's the position of the government. As a result, we've seen more infrastructure projects in Hong Kong. For instance, expenditure in capital works rose from $62 billion last term to $70 billion this year. And this is going to continue to rise. And Mr. John Zhang claims that he is going to set up a future fund to replace the land fund and to save up for future infrastructure projects. And what does Mr. Sau-lan say? I think he doesn't buy this idea. He wants to spend money directly on people's livelihoods, so he claimed. And therefore, he has substantially increased the recurrent expenditure. But policy is usually lagged behind. And people have the feeling that he doesn't practice what he preaches. And people's livelihood are not really improved. So government continues to rely on goodies to relieve the public of the financial plight. So this year, we still have to spend about $20 billion on so-called goodies. Mr. Sau-lan would like to spend more on social welfare and education, whereas Mr. John Zhang is set on using infrastructure. The two has no consensus. So whether you like Mr. Sau-lan's approach or Mr. John Zhang's approach, neither works. But there must be a decision. You must make a choice between the two. And yet, within the government, I think they have split ideas. And if there is no conciliation, no compromise, then this kind of internal bickering will cause Hong Kong is economic development. I think this philosophy in fiscal management alone will be enough for the Civic Party to vote against the budget. And for many years, we have criticized the government in that the FS has not come up with a convincing way to address our fiscal structural problems. The government has no commitment, no ambition, no vision whatsoever to address this problem. It is really hard to support such a government when it has gone to such a state. According to Hong Kong News Opinion Poll, when the budget was first announced, the popularity dropped to 45% and scored a record low to 48.5 since 2008. So, if the budget is actually spending more, how come people's level of dissatisfaction has gone up? That means people are not satisfied with just minor patch-up measures. and these goodies. We want to have long-term planning and undertaking to improve our situation. So it is normal that the budget scored so low in the poll. As we all know, the community has already got a confidence crisis. According to Hong Kong News Opinion Poll, people who have confidence in Hong Kong has been dropping consistently. A latest poll indicated that only 52.6% of the respondents had confidence in Hong Kong, a substantial drop of 30% compared to what it was 5 years ago. And we have dropped to the level in 2003.
Those people who are not confident about our future are mostly the middle class. And in the budget, there is practically nothing for the middle class. And there is no coverage about SMEs. The Civic Party proposes assistance schemes for people with the children. For the first 3 years after the birth of the child, there can be a tax refund, subject to a cap of 36,000, and there is also an medical care for elderly tax concession to be capped at $50,000 a year. We've also proposed to relaunch the special credit guarantee scheme for the SME. Well, given the tense relationship between the executive and the legislature, we are not surprised that our proposals are not taken up. But we need some kind of assistance, however small. Even though it's a drop in the ocean, it will be better than not talking about it at all. Yes, it is true that Hong Kong people have no confidence. It's because apart from the small circle election and also the monopoly of a handful of conglomerates, in addition, we lack overall planning. The government doesn't give us any hope for our future. The FS created this future fund. But what we're afraid is that we have a future fund, but we don't have a future, because that would be disastrous. The Working Group on Long-Term Physical Planning has got one member who is quite frank. It's Mrs. Wong. She said that the revenue in the reserve or the future fund is just the same money in different pockets of the same jacket. It's just that if we put it in the future fund, then people will not covet it. So to put it bluntly, the future fund is to take some pressure off the government's shoulders against criticisms that they have money and not spend it. And there is still no confirmation about the purpose of the future fund. Some say that it is for infrastructure. KK Chen, the secretary for FST, said that the future fund is to sustain infrastructural projects. But when the grass is growing, the steed starves. But we're yes, I know that in name it is for the future, but it seems that when it comes to the future, this fund will not be of any help. And if you do not tackle problems that you are facing, it will be too late for you to spend money trying to salvage the situation when is already badly hurt by current problems. I feel sorry for John Zeng. Do you want John Zeng to just give CY Leung a free rein to do everything he wants by giving him the money. We see that for CY Leung, where he sounds grand, but he doesn't do anything. He said he would do away with the offsetting mechanism under the MPF. He said he would start a universe. He would start the universal retirement protection scheme. Now, he hasn't done any of those. What he's done is to give $2 million to those that are close to him to do a few surveys and polls and to set up a couple of temporary posts for this so-called Let's Talk and Achieve Genuine Universal Suffrage. If John Zhang doesn't dance to the tune of CY Leung, he has his own reasons. He has quoted a song from Crossroads of Danny Summer. He said he doesn't believe in destiny, but he believes in opportunities. I so submit. Does any other member wish to speak? If there are no, Mr. Porter. Thank you, President. There is no Cantonese saying. You wear your jewelry to run away from a war. Perhaps for the younger generation, it's something unfamiliar. It means that if you are rich and during hard times, say in a war, even if you keep your jewelry, not only is it useless to you, it may also bring bad luck because people may rob you. And according to John Zhang, RFS, he wants to just move the reserves somewhere else so that people will not covet it. I think he has his reasons. I've listened to members' speeches, most of them criticisms. And sometimes I feel you can't please everyone. Some people ask for import of foreign labor, some are dead against it, and some talks about developer hegemony and that government is blindly scrambling for land. The more you hear it, the more sick and tired you become. But in a society where we try to be as democratic as possible, we will have to listen to everyone. Whether it is in the Legislative Council or in the court, I've always said that politics and the law actually comes from the same root. The public is a jury and judge about a way forward. I hope officials do not mind listening to views that they don't approve of, but they need to be here to listen to views. They should be able to take criticisms on the chin. When it comes to looking for land, looking for your way forward, sometimes because of the buildings, the trees, it disorientates you. And we use compass to show your way. But it only shows you the general direction. You will have to find a path yourself. Whether you're left, center, or right, you can spend forever in a debate of how to spend money. But I think the general direction is the basic law that we have to be basically a capitalist system. We will not have a socialist system. We do not have a welfare system, a welfare state system. But we hear a lot of exceptions, say for example, restrictions on formula milk and the cooling measures of the properties. I hope these are temporary in nature. to go around when we encounter stumbling blocks. The most important thing is to be able to find your way forward in a myriad of criticisms and objections. When I think when it comes to use of money, you will have to be prudent, you will have to keep your spending within your income, and you have to use it when it's necessary. So these are just basic basic principles. Let me first talk about keeping your cost down. Let's look at the rate of return of the exchange fund. And in 2013, 6.7%. MPF has been criticized heavily, but still they have a rate of return of 8.09%. It seems that Mrs. Chan is doing better than Mr. Chan. And some members talked about sovereign fund. Let's look at Norway. It's the number one of sovereign fund. They have 15% as their rate of return. Singapore and Australia, their funds have been performing well. So when it comes to increasing our income, do we have to get a better understanding of the situation? Well, apart from hiding the money so that people will not covet it, we should do more than just putting a seed in the earth. We have to help it grow. This time round, the budget is once again a disappointment because there is no general direction or vision in it. Let's talk about spending only when it's necessary. Of course, you help people who are in need, the underprivileged and the elderly people. They need our help. And this is something that we've been talking about a number of years. We have the ability to provide dental services or healthcare services to them, and it's our duty. Mr. Greg So, the secretary, is here. Let me talk about tourism. The TIC, Tourism Industry Council, has the duty to promote Hong Kong's tourism. But just like a restaurant, when it's constantly full and the kitchen can't cope with it, should the restaurant continue to advertise, or should they think about how they can maintain the service level, how to keep the business running to the satisfaction of customers instead of spending money on more advertisement, and perhaps to find ways to try to screen out some customers. And I know that currently, apart from sticking to our old way, they have enhanced publicity. Well, I know that you can't cut manpower, but you can cut publicity and advertisement. And when it comes to the mega event fund, there will be an increase of $85.5 million on it. You need to consider whether to use the money to improve our infrastructure or put them to better uses instead of putting it to where it will only increase our pressure. Please consider it. And there is also the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge. It will be commissioned in June. The XRL talks about a 1-hour living circle. This will also increase the number of incoming visitors. It's not just about our capacity to receive visitors. It's just like a columnist said, how many of these people are genuine visitors? Or they are simply customers who come here to buy quality products. If you don't get a clear understanding of the question, you will not be able to put in place effective measures to tackle the problem. We're a major window in the south of China. We have a huge appeal to visitors. A lot of people come to Hong Kong to shop and then they leave.
So we've been talking about the 1 hour living circle, but then for those who have benefited from it and for those who accept this notion, what we have spent so much money on the infrastructure projects together with the build up city, together with the promotion of our entertainment and other industries, is not just to benefit the 7 million Hong Kong population. We might be extending it to the tens of millions of people living within that circle, and there are bound to be more conflicts. And if we do not clarify that, if we are not sure about who's a visitor, who's a customer buying their daily necessities, we might be missing the target. So we might be targeting the wrong people, and we might misunderstand the problem. Now, coming back to another issue, that's the cruise terminal. Basically, it's neither here nor there, because we have compressed the commencement or commissioning date, but then the arrangements or the facilities are not ready. And recently, there have been press reports that have been pretty negative about this, and we have to face up to the issue. We should not wait till 2015 before we think hard about how this travelator system should work. We have to make sure that for the 5-minute walking distance from Kowloon East, that the connectivity can be well built so that there would not be bottlenecks. And in terms of buses, parking in the area, there should not be any conflict. And also because of a short supply of parking spaces, well, taxis and buses might be reluctant to go there. Or if there is this bottleneck, then there would be problems. Another issue is about transparency. As a body responsible for public finances, well, when it comes to members' questions, for example, when we ask questions about the policy address, what's the attitude of the administration? Yes, there might be questions that have been put before them for asking sake. And of course, this is not good. But then in terms of the number of questions and also in terms of the scope of the questions, there might need to be more restrictions so that members will not just be asking questions for asking sake. But then if you look at the administration's reply, that leaves a lot to be desired. Sometimes they would just be wishy-washy, or in some cases they would simply say that they are not going to answer it. I asked a question, and it's about our information coordinator, and he used an alias to write articles and so on. So I was asking whether or not he made some non-disclosed income, and they just refused to answer. And it's not just a simple yes or no. They didn't bother to tell us whether or not he had sought approval or whatever. And also, for many years, we have Gordon Wu, who has insisted in serving the community, and very often, he said that we had this problem of having the consultants surrounding Hong Kong. When it comes to the cross-harbor tunnels, we spent $7 million on the consultancy study. And even when we talk about how we can resolve the problem of congestion, they actually engage Stanford U and also MIT to conduct studies. And of course, experts are people that we should respect, because as a professional, he has expertise in his own field. But then if we overdo it, or if we just blindly believe in overseas studies, and if we just hastily engage consultants to conduct studies and so on, that might not have been in line with the principle of using the money where it's most needed. And when we ask the individual bureaus as to how much they spend on consultancy studies, and the administration's reply is that the scope is too broad, that's why they said that they are not able to answer the questions. That's why, in the end, I can only approach individual bureaus. And Mr. Greg Soh's bureau said that during the past 3 years, they spent $12 million. And of course, one of the studies would be the study on the Hong Kong TV, free TV license. Given the fact that we have a lot of expertise and we have been spending so much public money with this with a sizable civil service, we should have avoided engaging consultants into various studies. We should not just be doing this for the sake of reducing our workload and for the sake of having someone bearing or taking up the blame when there are criticisms. That's not the way to spend public money. Mr. President, whilst I still have some time left, I'd like to make 2 points. Well, the budget has been broadly criticized, at least initially, for its failure to take care of the middle class. Well, honestly, the middle class doesn't need you to take care of them. But then please do not undermine some of our directions. Well, as I said, we need the direction shown to us by the compass, and therefore we should leave it to the public to make the judgments. And recently, in the UK, they talk about something which was highly controversial, but then it was also highly popular. That is that they'd like to scrap the so-called pension so that their citizens could decide when they'd like to withdraw the money from their account. But then in our case, we do not trust our citizens, and we have been taking away the money from the citizens, and we have been keeping it within the public coffers. And as a result, the public does not have the money that they need so that they can invest in their children's education and in whatever they want, even for trips and so on. Well, the overriding principle is that we should follow our old track, because that's the way why Hong Kong takes. Any other member who would like to speak? Mr. Lam Kwok-hung. Mr. President, well, we talk about filibustering, and I heard the pro-establishment camp led by Mr. Tam Yu Chong, and he said that once you filibuster, you're going to do damage to our community. Well, I don't know how he got a figure of $20 million being spent on filibustering last year. Yes, call it if you like, that is a waste of public money. Well, we have meeting every Wednesday, but then every Wednesday we would just debate on non-binding motions, and then afterwards nothing will happen and its community will not change as a result of that. And in fact, with an executive hegemony in Hong Kong, that is for amendment to law and legislative right, this council has been castrated in many senses, and therefore we have not been able to do anything at all. So my filibustering is actually done on the basis of that. That is, we have been very helpless, and that's why I am trying to make use of the residual power that we still have in order to make sure that the administration will be made aware of these problems. So after the budget is passed, well, what will Hong Kong people get in return? Well, you might say that, well, the pro-establishment camp just lie whenever they like. So apparently you're suggesting that Hong Kong people will not be able to get the sweetness that they need. Has the administration said that? Does it mean that they will have short-term financial difficulty, and as a result they're not going to give the handouts? They will still be giving the handouts. Well, why don't we put it that way? I'll lower my requirement, given the fact that you like the handouts so much. All right. Why don't we just ask the administration to double all the handouts that they are giving? So how about increasing it by threefold? All right, if they have to get their wages 2 months late, then how about requiring them or making them pay three times the handouts? And if you think that universal retirement protection is going to be a major change in the system, and the administration is not going to do it anyway, and therefore filibustering will just waste our time. So my question for the pro-establishment camp, including the DAB and the FTU, is it not what you've been asking for many years? You've been fighting for it for several decades. What have you done to make sure that it will be realized? All right, for those who say that filibustering is not going to work, either they say that the sweetener is too small, well, why don't you just seek mercy from them? So it's not working. So why don't you come up with a way of realizing that? And I'm trying to ensure that there'll be a system change, and yet you say that it's not working. So what kind of logic is that? Once again, I'd like to say this. I'd like to ask those who are against filibustering, why don't you take out some courage to make sure that the administration will bow to some pressure so that it will do what we ask them to do? All right, coming back to the subject under discussion. Well, this budget by John Zhang, well, he said that there's no money. I think this year is even more meaningful to filibuster, because last year I asked him to set up this Universal Retirement Protection Fund. Once again, I'd like to set it out. That is for the $50 billion set aside so that before 2017 you can work it out. That's very simple. So that's before Sau-lan steps down. We take out $50 billion to set up this fund. And now John Zhang is saying that, well, for the land fund, why don't we put it into another account called Future Fund? And actually, for the account on for the account of Future Fund, that will take up all the surplus that we're going to have in future years. So he said that you don't need to think about anything at all, because if I misjudge the situation, then everything will be put into this account. So he will resolve all the problems of misjudgment by putting all the money into this account. All right, don't expect me to give you handouts again in the future. Everything will go into this Future Fund account. So what is this Future Fund about? So he, he is less than human. The fact that he has the gutter to tell us this. All right, he said that according to our projections, with an aging population and after people age, we will have fewer we will have less manpower, and productivity will come down, and as a result, we will have a situation whereby our expenditure will exceed our revenue, and therefore we have to save up money for infrastructure building, so that as a result of our recurrent expenditure, that is, we have to meet with people's livelihoods demands, because if that should increase, then we will not be deprived of money. So at least we have a pool of money available. In other words, well, for this government, for the helpless elders, in particular housewives who have not been taken care of, and the cumulative effect is now being treated as a social burden. So I think you are inhuman. In other words, you're saying that we should not support our mothers or mums. All right, the children are saying that, well, mum, why don't you think about it? All right, for the brothers and sisters, they're actually enjoying their lives and they're spending all the money. And then they are saying that, well, by the time when mum gets older, then we will not be able to cope with that. It will be too much of a burden to us. And that's why for the money that we're going to use to support our parents, why don't we just put it aside so that we can continue to speculate on commodities, and then we can use that to support our parents in the future. How can that be right? So my question for all of you here is, well, for those who are not supported, who are frail and weak, so do you not agree that they have contributed their whole life to our community? So the fact that they are not supported right now is not because of the problem of today, it's a problem of yesterday. So if you do not resolve them now, actually it will become a problem of tomorrow. So they say that for recurrent spending, if it goes up all the time, then we will not be able to make ends meet. So they have also got it wrong again. So I think for the projections, they've always got them wrong. But then the figures are here. Well, for the projections, you can get them wrong. But then, from 2007 to now, we're talking about some $20.6 billion on capital spending, and now it has gone up to 78.2, so up by 194%. During the same period, education only went up by 40%, and healthcare only went up by 69%. Welfare only went up by 77%. And still, he says that, all right, for the money used to make stone is not enough. And our elders, our education, they are taking up too much. So are you terminally ill? And then in 2014, that is this year, well, in the year that I am planning to filibuster, well, we have $78.2 billion for capital spending or for infrastructure spending. So it has taken up the lion's share of all government spending, education, welfare, and healthcare. They are actually second to this. And if you look at the ratio of public spending, since 2005, for infrastructure, it went up by 37.1% on average. And then welfare, 5.6%. So it's just a fraction of that. And healthcare, just 1.6%. Education, under Eddie Ng, all right, at 2005, it has nothing to do with him. All right, it dropped by 21.3%. Buddy, think about it. What kind of figures are these? That's why, as a philosopher, well, I ask this figure, I ask this question. Some people wonder why I ask this. All right, if he's a philosopher, he's less than human. All right, as an economist, he has got it wrong. Because when you say that, well, if a place has to be competitive, then the most important thing is productivity. By that, we mean that it's about the people's education attainment, whether or not an individual is able to develop his potential in a community. So when I read out those figures, well, education, social security, healthcare, or hygiene, well, spending in those areas have come down. So what are you telling me? You said that recurrent spending, and also Hong Kong is having spending too much on welfare. Well, on infrastructure, we are spending $77.8 billion. If we were able to spend $7.8 billion on education, then all those students within the right age groups would be able to go into universities instead of receiving sub-degree programs or undergoing sub-degree programs. So they do not have to go to second-class universities. They do not have to go bankrupt because they have to go into these programs, which are not university programs. So with investment in education, these children will be able to become more competitive, and therefore our soft power will become stronger.
And their parents, who are old, or in the later part of middle age, don't need to bear the heavy cost of university education. Now you pay $7.8 billion, but you're not willing. Now this year you spend $78.2 billion on infrastructure, but that is good enough for 10 years of education reform. Look at kindergarten education. The promise is 15 years of free education, it becomes 15 years free of education. Education is based on money, and they only look at money. The cross-border students, the loyalists have been clamoring for that. Is there anybody doing anything on this? Now, if every dollar is put into the future fund, then these future problems cannot be resolved because there is no money to solve these problems. Now, finally, on the Social Security Fund, C.Y. Leung, I believe, gave you his manifesto when he was doing electioneering. He said that a suitable juncture, there should be retirement protection. Now, this is the second year. I've already reminded him. And if he didn't die, then he is nearing the end of his term. When is the suitable hour? I asked him to set aside $50 billion for retirement protection. Will he do it in the third year, fourth year? If he cannot honor his promise, then he should bow down and ask for forgiveness. I'm just asking him to set aside $50 billion as seed money, and then before 2017. He's already got Nelson Chow to help him. Why can't you do it? So it's very simple. Last year, when we did filibustering, we were not very certain about the objective. Were we too greedy? But if you look at the future fund, it's all on rocks and mortar, or bricks and mortar, but not on people. In fact, infrastructure can be done overseas. You can get mainlanders to build our infrastructure. they are going to expand on infrastructure with the multiplying effect that will drive the economy and raise wages. That will not happen because you can import labor. What's the purpose of our infrastructure? It's just to fit in with the 12-5-year plan. The express rail was an example. At that time, you were not the president of. There would be exceedance of cost by of budget by $20 billion, and it would only be completed in 2017. And that's making use of infrastructure just to window dress GDP, and then you turned it into bricks and mortar, and then you put it up for speculation. When there are assets, then you can privatize the assets. That will help certain companies to have more assets. And that's the policy of CY Leung. There is no difference between Donald Zhang and CY Leung. One says categorically that he is not going to give out any sweetener. He is going to exploit the people and just put up more buildings. And CY Leung is just giving out a small amount of sweeteners. The reform is just in bits and pieces, say a carer's allowance. That's only for the those who care for the elderly, but not for the disabled. Low-income allowance, that is also in bits and pieces. And there are just bureaucracies. I think it's the right time, a more mature time for filibustering. So you have to wait and see. Filibustering is coming. Those members who are present have already spoken. Mr. Andrew Leung.
President, I move that the debate on the second reading of the Appropriation Bill 2014 be adjourned to the meeting of the 16th of April 2014. And I propose a question to you, and that is that the debate on the second reading of the Appropriation Bill 2014 be adjourned to the meeting of the 16th of April 2014. And I put a question to you as stated. Would those in favor please raise their hands? Those against, please raise their hands. I think the question is agreed by majority respect of each of the two groups of members, that is those returned by FCs and those returned by GCs through direct elections who are present. I declare the motion passed. This council will continue with the debate at the second reading of the Appropriation Bill 2014 at the meeting of the 16th of April 2014, during which public officers will respond. If the bill receives its second reading, its remaining stages will also be proceeded with at that meeting. Members' motion. The Honourable Andrew Leung will move a motion.